Jerry Tarkanian was a fighter. He defended his players without excuse. He challenged the establishment of college sports, and he spared no expense to save his reputation and legacy. He was an innovator in the game with his style of play and the way in which he gave his players the freedom to express themselves long before the Fab Five. He not only built a program from the dirt up in Las Vegas, but he helped alter the landscape of a blossoming town by creating the destination in an event-driven city. He won a title and claimed two victories few thought he could, a multi-million dollar settlement with the NCAA, and an induction into the Naismith Hall of Fame. His players and former assistants were and remained incredibly loyal. And in covering him for four seasons toward the end of his career in Fresno, he was a reporter's dream, never shying away from being quotable or creating plenty of anecdotes with his actions and followers. He was one of the characters in the game, a one-of-a-kind, who refused to conform and wore the scars of his detractors on his sleeve, embracing the drive to prove everyone wrong. His final win won't be recorded on a stat sheet, but he can finally say at the end, he was accepted, a triumph for him, family, his staff, his players, and his legion of fans.
Cut to the bucket or replace yourself. Don't just stand. One or the other. Hey, Danny, is he that good or is it just because you're guarding?
There's so many aspects to coaching, getting a group of people to play together and be unselfish and care about each other. I think it takes a unique person.
In a city just as unique, a roguish playground built on dreams, Jerry Tarkanian built his singular career. Tark owned Vegas. His running rebels were a latter-day Rat Pack, the hottest show on the Strip.
They were the sports franchise in Las Vegas. Whether you were a big shot casino executive or were a bus in a hotel, people loved this team. It was their team. We didn't have a pro team.
From 1973 to 1992, Tarkanian was the sad-eyed face of UNLV, the familiar image of his sucking a towel during tense games, juxtaposed with highlights of his unrelenting offense and elite talent on the court. Tarkanian coached UNLV to more than 500 wins in 19 seasons, four times taking the Rebels to the Final Four. His crowning glory was his 1990 team, still recalled with awe. That Vegas team ran Duke off the floor by 30 points in the national championship game. The next season, Tark's club was just as fearsome, just as flamboyantly up-tempo.
Thank you. UNLV honored the late Jerry Tarkanian with a pregame video tribute and by placing a chair from the 1990 Final Four with a folded towel on it on the sideline.
That's really cool.
Fans were given commemorative towels that said Tark on them, and Las Vegas casinos on the Strip and downtown shut off their lights for 3 minutes after the game.
Shut down their lights. I don't think they shut off their lights. They turned them really down, though.
Temporarily. Yeah. Some of them turned them off, from what I saw.
Okay.
Tark's tribute was blank.
It was fitting. I think they've only done this for a handful of people in the desert. It's cool. It's like Vegas cool. You know, Tark doesn't work everywhere. Tark worked in Vegas. The towel thing, just kind of how he patrolled the sidelines, the Italian restaurants, the Gucci Row, like all that stuff is kind of classic old school Vegas. And so too was the celebration of his life with the dimming of the lights in the city.
Share with our viewers what you were telling us just a short while ago.
Well, the thing about it is when you saw them making their run, going to the Final Four, winning the national championship in 1990, you know, the Greg Anthony's, the Stacey Augmans, the Larry Johnsons of the world, you saw what they were all about, what they were capable of doing. But when you thought about the Running Rebels, as an African-American, you looked at the fact that he was a guy that gave folks who needed second chances. He was a guy that was willing to go up against the system because he challenged the system because he didn't believe that the system was being fair to a bunch of kids that looked like me and were from the same kind of neighborhoods I was from. So because of that, you found yourself rooting for them because they seemed to represent not just themselves and UNLV, but a community at large who felt relatively voiceless until the Hoyas came and gave us a voice, until the Running Rebels followed years later and gave us a voice. It's a tremendous loss to the basketball community today because those of us who know at least a little something about his background have a deeper and greater level of appreciation for who he was and what he represents. And we certainly, even though we don't understand it to the degree that his son expressed what he expressed, we understand where he's coming from because if we feel the way we felt about him, could you imagine how his son is feeling about him right now?
Tough day. When you think back to the early 1990s, we were also talking and watching them play. It was theater when you had UNLV playing and when they would go up against Duke. I mean, the public persona, it was such polar opposites. It truly was
and they were from Central Casting. You know,
yes,
Duke's the good
absolutely.
Guy.
And it's interesting.
Then,
if they had, when they annihilated Duke in that national championship game, mm-hmm. We weren't unhappy about it. A lot of folks that I grew up with weren't unhappy about it at all.
Thank you. wasn't just a coach. He was an iconic figure. While stars lit up the strip, Tark the Shark performed at the old convention center and Thomas and Mack, his show, The Runnin' Revs.
Now watching from the sideline, and here's Honda Lowe coming in on Leitner and it'll fall.
You know, he's a larger-than-life figure. You know, he really was like a father to so many of us. And you had to love the guy, you know, in terms of playing for him. You know, he pushed us, obviously, and got us to reach our potential as not just basketball players, but as people. And we're always going to be forever in debt for that.
His coaching numbers are eye-popping. From 1973 to 1992, Jerry Tarkanian never had a losing record. His Runnin' Rebel teams won over 500 games and made it to the postseason 14 times, including a run at 9 consecutive NCAA tournament appearances. He also reached the Final Four 4 times, winning a national championship in 1990.
For me, it was the love and the camaraderie that we had for each other. I mean, you know, it just wasn't one incident. Everything, you know, every day was a circus. Every day, either you cried or you laughed.
Coach was a great motivator. You know, one thing a lot of people, you know, say about his coaching, but he could motivate you to play against the last place team in the league. So he was a great motivator. That's what I really remember. From playing under Coach Tark.
To me, he was a father figure. It was a different experience, an everlasting experience, you know, to where, you know, you're playing for a coach that sucks water out of a towel, you know, and get the name Shark. That's incredible.
Tarkanian's teams were known for their stifling defense and up-tempo style. He put the running in the Runnin' Rebels and put UNLV on the map.
But one of the things that made Tarkanian so special, he was a motivator. He motivated the team. He told you when you do good things, you know, he mentioned it. And then when you do bad things, he will let you know as well.
In 2013, UNLV recognized Tarkanian, putting his likeness near the front door. Inside, they named their courts in his honor, his imprint on UNLV from the floor to the ceiling and beyond. His name, his legacy, forever linked to UNLV.
Well, the town was great. The community was totally behind the team. It was a great group of guys. It was a great time for everybody in Las Vegas.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the court the Patty Pennington Gospel Ensemble from the House of Blues Gospel Brunch. Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, please stand for the invocation, which will be offered by former Runner Rebel basketball player, Pastor Richard Box.
Thank you, Rebel Nation. It is indeed an honor to be here and a pleasure on this occasion. We're here to celebrate life. Coach Tarkanian once told me a story about when he was at Fresno State with his team, and during his initial years here, the team was a little bit not together, a little fragmented, and he went into a restaurant to eat, and the players were sitting at different tables, two over here, one over there, and the coach, the waitress said, "Excuse me, sir, are you the coach?" He said, "Yes," and then he said, "You think you could get your team together?" And he said, "Ma'am, I've been trying to do this all year long. If you have any suggestions, let me know." I think the coach has done a wonderful job, even in his passing, in bringing everyone together, just as he did in our community. Jesus said in John chapter 3:16, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. We believe today the coach has gone to heaven, and he has that everlasting life, and he has professed Jesus as his Lord and as his Savior. Let me pray. Father, thank you for this opportunity, and thank you for this celebration of life. Thank you for the people that are here. And, Lord, thank you for this incredible man. Thank you for this incredible family. They are due honor today. And we are here to honor Coach, all that he represents. There are a lot of wonderful stories that will be told here. There are a lot of blessings that will be told. God, we thank you that you have brought all this together. We thank you for the influence in the university, the influence in our city, the influence in on our nation, and even in the basketball nation, the influence that has gone worldwide. Lord, we celebrate that today. We thank you for this opportunity. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. God bless you guys. Thank you.
Rebel fans, please welcome to the court our MC for today, ESPN broadcaster and former UNLV student-athlete, Kenny Mayne.
So Richard does a prayer, and then I'm going to follow with how I learned to play dice in Las Vegas at age 9. I see how it goes. True story, how I fell in love with this town way back when, before I got to go to college here. My dad worked for the airline, so we could fly anywhere for like $3. First day of school in third grade, Mrs. Loomis, you know, asking everybody what they did. And Tommy went to church camp, and the other kid, you know, went to Boy Scout camp. And I'm like, my dad took me to Vegas. You learn a lot about math and crafts. You do. And I had this inkling that I was destined to come here at some point. There was something about the town I liked from a distance, and I wasn't all that. I get better every year in football, but I wasn't really that good back then. I was kind of all arm, no head, and really hasn't changed. But when UNLV came and talked about me possibly coming down here, they ended up going with Sam King ahead of me. If you need insurance in the area, go to Sam King, great guy. They made the right choice. But it wasn't just coming to Vegas to play football. It was like, that's the school that has Tarkanian. Like he was this headline. He was Sinatra, and he was the draw about UNLV. Not that Tony Knapp wasn't an offensive genius and a great man, but Jerry Tarkanian, his name, his imprint was on UNLV in this town, Las Vegas. I remember asking him years later, once or twice the NCAA had called him, and I said, so how does it work? What's the deal with the schooling, with the kids? And he's like, you know what, in his gravelly voice, if I were at Johns Hopkins, I'd have all doctors. And if I were at Harvard, I'd have all lawyers. And if I were at MIT, I'd have all scientists. But I'm proud to be at UNLV. And I personally am proud that I was associated with the same school that Jerry Tarkanian was and all the great things he did here. We can all Google his record. Looks pretty good in the history of college basketball. Hall of Fame, that speaks for itself. But you know what? I think his true legacy was love. And the love he had for the game and for his players and the love that was returned, and it's going to manifest here today with for all of you that came out to honor him in this final time and going forward as we remember him. But when you talk to players, and again, I bring up my old coach, Tony Knapp, it's like having a second father figure. Like, you can count on him in so many ways. And there were so many players, when you hear them speak today and when you hear them speak in other forums, it comes through. There was a deep affection and adoration for Coach Tarkanian. And it wasn't just that they were having fun on the court. They played fun because they had fun because they were winning and they played a certain style. But there was all the hard work that went into it. So he taught so many lessons. And he's touched so many people, not just in basketball, but in a lot of ways. And I think we have the picture from Del Mar. That's where I got to know him a little bit better in his later years after he retired. I'm a horse race fan. I might have cut class once or twice with Ray Krause and Leon Walker to go to the sports books, but it paid off later because I did cover horse racing and use my UNLV broadcasting career. But at Del Mar, Coach Tark would sit up on the porch right above the paddock, and he was open to anyone. People would come by and tell him how much they admired him as a coach. He loved people, and he loved life, and it showed all the way to his final days. He liked being around and being in the mix, and people loved to have that affection, that closeness to him. You're going to hear all day long about all those who were affected by him in different ways and what he meant to him, particular stories. But we're going to start with the current athletic director here at UNLV, Tina Kunzer Murphy.
thank you, Kenny. It's great to have you here. I think a lot of people in the audiences remember you from school, and they have lots of stories. But on behalf of UNLV Athletics, it is my pleasure to welcome each and every one of you here today as we celebrate the life, the character, the contributions of the greatest running rebel of all time, Coach Jerry Tarkanian. Today's event is a celebration. It's about sharing our memories and our stories. It's about sharing our laughter and our friendship. And yes, we'll probably all end up sharing a few tears as well. But today is also about saying thank you to Coach Tark, who brought so much joy and happiness to so many of us in this arena. To his wonderful family, Lois, Pam, Jody, George, Danny, the 11 grandchildren and extended family, thank you for the sacrifices you made and for the unending support you provided to Coach and his players and for sharing him with us. Thank you. To his former players, many of whom are with us today, you know this, that Coach believed in you, he fought for you, he challenged you, and most importantly, he thought of you as members of his own family. He loved you very, very much. And to our Running Rebel fans, Coach Tark appreciated you. He loved what you did at the convention center and what you brought and the joy you brought to the Thomas and Mack. Thank you all so very much. I had the great fortune of working with Coach for 20 years here at UNLV, and like so many of us who knew him, he had a profound effect on my life. Coach Tark was a believer. He believed in the power of the human spirit. He believed in the value of hard work and tenacity, and he believed in fairness and equality. He believed in education and the power of sport to transform our lives, and he believed in this great city of Las Vegas. He believed in the promise of what UNLV could be as a university, and he was never, ever afraid to stand up for, and if necessary, fight for, what he knew was right. Like so many of you here today, I'll carry with me and forever treasure a lifetime of wonderful memories. And today, I am so grateful to have the chance to say thank you, Tark. Coach Tarkanian, thank you so much. I'm pleased now to introduce and welcome the president of UNLV, someone who understands and appreciates the proud heritage of Running Rebel basketball and what Coach Tarkanian meant to our university, Dr. Lynn Jessup.
Many of you know, and I'm afraid to admit this in front of this group, but in the late 1980s, I was a graduate student at the University of Arizona, right in the midst of the rivalry between U of A and UNLV. I'm sorry. But I know I'm biased, but I consider that to be one of the best rivalries in college basketball, possibly ever. It was perfect in many ways. And I can tell you that we had a deep respect for Coach Tarkanian and for UNLV. That's the first point I wanted to make. Jerry Tarkanian's legacy stretches far beyond the game of basketball. Southern Nevada and the nation were introduced to UNLV because of him. He gave Las Vegas a reason to cheer, but he made Running Rebel basketball at UNLV a brand name during his 19 years, really creating a national brand around UNLV. The other thing I wanted to say is that on a personal level, Jerry Tarkanian was also great with his players, and that's been mentioned here by Tina and by Kenny. And I would say that he loved his players. He understood the importance also of giving people a second chance. And his players were loyal to him because of it. He believed in them. He fought for them. He gave them opportunities no one else could or would. Jerry touched many lives and will be deeply missed as a result. His passing creates a void not only for his wife, Lois, kids and grandkids, and for all of us, all the UNLV faithful. He'll be fondly remembered as a great college basketball icon and, I think more important, a great figure in our university's history. He clearly put UNLV on the map, and for that, all of us here at the university are forever grateful. I'm going to go. Yeah, thank you. I'm going to go off script for just a moment. I want to just quote. I'm going to paraphrase from some famous words I'm sure you'll recognize by a great American president, Teddy Roosevelt. This, for me, captures Jerry Tarkanian and his legacy. You'll recall the speech in Paris. It's not the critic who counts. The people in the arena are... The credit belongs to the person who's actually in the arena fighting the fight, who at best knows in the end the triumph of high achievement, and who at worst, if he or she fails, at least fails while daring greatly, so that his place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who know neither victory or defeat. Words to live by a great American president that fit very well for a great coach and a great man. Thank you. Go Rebels.
As a member of the Basketball Hall of Fame board, I am embarrassed to say that he has never been nominated for the Basketball Hall of Fame. That's something that's got to change.
When I took this job, I felt that we could be very competitive in our league, but I never anticipated us getting to the level that we got to.
This win is for the kids, but it's mostly for the great people in the state of Nevada. The whole state supports us, and I'm just so happy for them.
Basketball world has lost a great coach, a great mentor. I'm also grateful that I had the time with him.
Man, he taught me a lot, on and off the court. He took me out of a bad situation and put me in a great situation. I can never forget this guy.
People talk about the national championship being the crowning achievement, but 20 years after the fact, I think that what we all remember was the camaraderie of our team, the environment that Coach Tark established. And it was just an environment that was 100% conducive to success.
Greatest experience of my career. Greatest experience of my career.
My dad was the best person I've ever met, and I'm sure the best person I'll ever meet.
I think it can go without noting, after Coach Tark's passing just in the last couple months, Dean Smith, just recently Anthony Mason, Jerome Kersey, now Tark, and my boy Stuart Scott, I guess vehicle. I'll find out later, but I'm imagining they're having a good conversation up there. And back down here, so many coaches played against him and had just this high respect for the way he put it together and the kind of love he showed his players in the game. Got a chance to speak right after Coach Tark's passing. Here it is.
I already miss Coach Tarkanian. One of the greatest compliments ever paid to me personally was when Coach Tark said, I love watching your teams. They play so hard and guard. It's the way the game's supposed to be played. When he said that to me, it made me feel good that we were on the right track. Because here was a guy who, when he coached, his teams played with reckless abandon defensively. They attacked offensively. They had a ball playing. He gathered people. People wanted to be around it. They wanted to be around him. I wanted to be around him. I wanted to learn from him. He always brought me in. He always treated me like a son. What I love most, he took kids from all kind of different backgrounds. And he said, my job is to make your life better. Wherever you started, I want you to take strides up to the next step. And you think about every player that he's coached. Did he take some chances? I've taken chances. Every coach out there has. But we all took chances just like Coach. With the idea we can make this young man move in the right direction and be better.
My heartfelt condolences to the Tarkanian and UNLV family. Jerry obviously had a great impact on me during my entire coaching career, not just when I was with him in San Antonio. And I think the thing that made him so great was his ability to bring the best out of everyone around him. And I had a firsthand opportunity to coach Larry Johnson in New York, and I know how Larry felt about him and all the former UNLV players. They had great loyalty to Jerry because of the loyalty that Jerry showed them. And I think the way Jerry cared about people is what made him so special. And he certainly will go down as an iconic coach, one of the all-time greats, but an even better person, and you know, he will be missed.
What do you say about Tark, one of the great guys of all time? I can remember being a young coach, University of Akron, got the opportunity to do a Nike clinic, go into Ed Janka's room, Tark's there, came over and said, I watched your team, I really like what you're doing, and I'd try to ask him a question, and he'd ask me a question, and I'd try to go on and explain whatever he asked me, and then he would always finish with, is that right? And I never did get any answers from him, I don't think, until after he retired. And then asked him to come to Cincinnati and spend some time with us. He came in to Cincinnati, watched our team, went to practice. We went to dinner, talked to our team. I'll never forget, he told Kenyon Martin, he said, you know, when we got really good, when we were really, really good at Vegas, was when my best player was our hardest worker. And I think that kind of rang true with Kenyon, and he went on to have obviously a great career to a large degree, I think, because of Tark's influence. And that's the kind of guy he was. He was just a guy who loved basketball, loved basketball coaches. He was a coach's coach and a man's man, and I love him dearly, and we'll miss him.
Thank you so much for including me in this very, very special day. I'm so happy that all of you have gotten together to honor and celebrate a great life of a truly fantastic man. Jerry is one of the best coaches in any sport and really set the tone for how people should play pressure man-to-man defense. But he was more than that. He brought his personality and he created, you know, he created an amazing program at UNLV. You know, one of the best ever in college basketball history. My heart goes out to the Tarkanian family. Lois, we've sat in the Catholic Church sometimes in Las Vegas or in Final Fours. And, I know we share the same faith and the same belief that Jerry's probably coaching that pressure man to man with a lot of players up in heaven right now. I just wonder if he's able to take that towel with him, you know, because he really chomped on that thing. Yeah.
Hi everybody, I'm Dick Vitale of ESPN. First of all, I want to send my sympathy out and certainly our prayers to Jerry Tarkanian's beautiful wife, Lois, and her family. They are so special, special as people in every way. I want to simply tell you my little familiarity with Jerry Tarkanian. Jerry, to me, I used to always tease him, the Father Flanagan of coaching. If a kid had a little problem, Jerry was right there to give him a second chance in life. And oh, what a masterful job he did. I used to love going to practice. I would be in awe watching the unbelievable way with his passion, his intensity, his emotion, and getting his team and his players to play and represent the name in that front of that jersey. And oh, did they play. He won everywhere he coached on a collegiate level. Absolutely super scintillating. He was sensational. And then I loved Jerry as I would walk with Jerry on numerous occasions through the casinos, through the hotels. I thought I was with Francis Albert Sinatra. He was Mr. Las Vegas. Jerry certainly, certainly will be missed, but he will never, ever, ever be forgotten. He was awesome, baby, with a capital A.
I feel like Dick Vitale lacks energy, but he brought all he had to that. Coach Tarkanian made his biggest name here, as we all know. That's why we gathered today. But there was a basketball life, certainly before he made it to UNLV, and we're bringing up some of that life right now, going back a bit. Come on up, guys. From Riverside CC, Sam Knight. Pasadena CC, Sam Robinson. Long Beach State, his PR guy, Gary Wright. And Ed Ratliff from Long Beach State, hosted by DJ Allen.
Thanks, Kenny. Kenny, I don't know what you do for a living, but you're pretty good at this. You might have a career in it.
All right.
You know what's great about this? Here you go, fellas. What's great about this is that so many people, like myself, I was born and raised right here in Southern Nevada. In 1975, I was born. I do not know a world without Jerry Tarkanian and UNLV. And we didn't come to many games growing up. We didn't have a lot of money, and the family wasn't huge on sports. But I fell in love with the Running Rebels on Kadon Radio in 1982 after listening to the Dodgers and Vin Scully. I listened, and I remember going up, sitting at the very top of the arena, literally up in that section up there at some of these games. And so many of us are here today because we have those own personal stories about the Running Rebels. But the reality is that this is a family business. The reality is that Coach Tark did not come to Las Vegas until he was 42 years old. And he coached for 17 seasons at the high school level, 5 at the high school level, 7 at the JC level, and then 5 at Long Beach State. 17 seasons. Had success on the court, but more importantly, those are 17 rosters that he impacted lives on. And today, not only do we have the four gentlemen up here who we're going to get a chance to meet, but there are several members here who played at, he started his coaching career in high school. He started at San Joaquin Memorial High School in Fresno. Then he went to Antelope Valley High School. Then he went to Redlands High School. Then he coached at Riverside City College. He coached at Pasadena City College. And he coached at Long Beach State. Right before this today, I know the family hosted a brunch with former players, and not just the UNLV players, and not just Fresno. And Chris is going to come up and talk about Fresno. But there were many people here who played before UNLV. If you are here today, one of the former players who played before UNLV, please stand up. And Las Vegas, this is part of the Tark family. Let's tell them we love them. Sam Knight. You played for Coach at Riverside City College. He coached there for 5 seasons. You won 2 California state championships. Three.
Thank you. 3. I liked it. I think I was lowest. Love it.
3, and then 1 more at Pasadena, which we'll talk about. So 4 in a row. You won 2 yourself. What? Why? What did Coach have with that winning formula?
Well, what I remember is that Coach was the type of individual that demanded excellence. He always focused on our work ethic and the effort. We had a lot of role players, and I was one of the main ones in terms of hustling and rebounding and filling in where I needed to fill in. But we had a superstar in Bobby Rule and Roosevelt Lee, Joe Barnes, Tommy Crowder, Tom Farrell, Tom Quaz, John Barnico. I can go on and on. But these individuals really loved Coach because he was the one that augmented us all together. We were a mixed group, and we fought hard. We worked hard. All these players know how hard Coach worked us. And he reared back just like this in practice, seeing you work hard. He enjoyed that. But what it taught us was that if you want to win, you're going to have to work. That's the only way you're going to make it in this world is work. And that work ethic has carried me through my life. And I just want to say to the family, I really appreciate all the support that you've given me over the years. I've been knowing Jerry for over 50-some years, and Lois has been a tutor to me when I was going to City College, and Jerry was like a surrogate father. So I want to just personally thank you. And from the Riverside family, he's going to be dearly missed. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Sam. Our next 3 guests today who are part of the Tark family, and again, you think about that. He coached 43 years through high school, JC, and college. 19 were at UNLV. But that family, and this is a family business, and that's what we're celebrating today. Sam Robinson is unique because not only did you play for Coach at Pasadena City College, where after winning 3 in a row at Riverside, you went and won the first one at Pasadena, so won 4 in a row. You then went and played for him at Long Beach. Now, we were talking earlier about he went in and won right away. How was he able to do that?
Like Sam said, the work ethic. He taught fundamentals, and he taught things that I didn't learn in high school, which made us become better players and better person.
I know we talked a little bit about what the family and what Coach Tark meant to you and your family. What would you like to say to his family?
Well, it was 6 years after I left college. My mom passed away. Gideon came down and brought his whole family and helped pay for her funeral. That meant the world to me. That just goes to show you he was more than just a coach. He was a father figure. And I want to say to Lois, thank you for sharing your husband with me and my family, and to all the kids. Thank you for letting him be a father to me, which I didn't have coming up. I love you all from my heart.
Thank you, Sam. Thank you. 2 gentlemen that had great success at Long Beach State. Gary, I want you to talk about, so because we have so many UNLV fans, 5 years at Long Beach State, talk about the success in those 5 years for us.
Well, the first year was the tough one. We were 23-3 and didn't get invited to the NCAA tournament and should have. In the next 4 years, little Long Beach State not only went to the NCAA tournament 4 times, played in the Western Regional Finals twice, played in the Sweet 16 two other times. And remember this, this was in an era when in college basketball, if you were in the West, you played in the West. And so there was this other team, UCLA, and we gave them trouble. But I guarantee you, had it been like today, we'd have been in some Final Fours. These were great teams, but they had the same thing that Sam talked about, that and everybody else earlier, the work ethic. I used to love going to practice. I absolutely loved watching practice because they played so hard and they were so attentive. But also they played a different style. When we first saw a Vegas team, I was shaking my head. This is Tark's team. Played at Long Beach. It was a 1-2-2 zone defense. It was a power game on offense. If you shot the ball from 15 feet, even if you were open, there was a good chance you were sitting on the bench. So it was a different kind of game. He was able to adapt. And I think, again, that speaks of the genius that he was. I mean, the man was an absolute genius in so many ways and being able to help so many people.
And a pioneer at Long Beach State, where I believe two things is, number one, there was kind of unwritten rule at that time where you needed three white players to be starters. That was kind of in college basketball. And then also using the junior college system. And that's something, Sam, you went from Pasadena to Long Beach State, but he was a pioneer, wasn't he, in that right?
He didn't know white, black, green, gold. He didn't. He knew people. And that's all that mattered, and that's all that counted.
Thanks, Gary.
Let me say one other thing about those teams. Think about this. Again, little Long Beach State. When the final AP rankings came out, one year, Long Beach State finished third in the nation, and another year, fifth in the nation. Little Long Beach.
That's outstanding. And talk about a successful career, because in college athletics, we do have those who go on and play professionally, but so many don't. And it's about what our student athletes do in their careers. And Gary, in 1976, started with the Seattle Seahawks, a brand new franchise, and is still involved with them today. He's one of the he helped to build that franchise into what it is today. And all of that is part of the Tarkanian family, the legacies of what student athletes do as professionals.
And let me say that I don't have a career without Coach Tarkanian. He got me the Long Beach State job. He brought me, he taught me how to work hard. He taught me what it was to be successful. And it was the way he handled people. I remember Sports Illustrated having a story one time, and they talked about the Pied Piper. And that's what he was. People absolutely loved him, and they loved him because he was so genuine. He was just himself, and he just loved people. And he loved talking about basketball. But he also loved talking about his family, and his family was an integral part in this. The picture earlier of Danny sitting on the bench with his Long Beach State sweatshirt and Tark with his arm around him, that is my absolute favorite picture in sports. And what it is here is the father figure with his son and that great grin, and there's nothing that speaks more about Tark than family and basketball.
Thank you. And Ed, to have that success of those 5 years, going 123-20 in those 5 years, some pretty talented ball players. We talked a little earlier about a call that you received a few months ago. Will you tell our friends about that call?
Well, first of all, I'm glad Gary liked our practice. I'm glad he enjoyed it. Coach Tarkanian came in to Long Beach a couple of times, and one time he came in, he couldn't talk, or he didn't talk to us at all. And then I would always call over to the family, and most time it was to Jody, his daughter, to see how Coach is doing. So one time I called over to see how he's doing, and it was Lois's birthday, and I told her happy birthday that night. And she goes, "Hey, you can talk to my dad." And a month before that, he wasn't talking. He got on the phone, he talked to me. I mean, that was like a highlight. I got a chance to talk to him at that time, because he wasn't talking. But the phone call you're talking about, I got a call that they're going to induct me to the Basketball Hall of Fame. First person I called was Coach Tarkanian. I called Jody. I said, "Tell your dad that I'm going to be inducted." I tell him, I said, "Thank you for all the stuff he has done for me
and if it wasn't for him and the players we had, I probably wouldn't be inducted in there.
Well, I think the timing of this is just a few months ago. Ed, this November is going to get inducted in Kansas City into the College Basketball Hall of Fame because of Long Beach State.
You know what? Before I go, there are some players, I'll tell you about Coach and how much he means to a lot of us. There are some players from Long Beach that came in, and they're not happening to be down here. But Chuck Terry, Tap Nixon, Amon Ra, Glenn McDonald, they came all the way from Long Beach to be a part of this.
Will you? And we're so limited on time, and this will be the last question, but you have the family here. And we know Coach has played such a big role on you and your life. And for all the former players who played for Coach, what would you like to say to the family?
Well, they know how I feel. And it's, you know, you don't have to say much. As long as you show up all the time, you're always calling them and you talk to them, see how things are going. I think they understand how you feel. I'm very, very close to them. Coach Tarkanian, Tat Nixon used to say, "How's Daddy Tark doing?" He would always say that to me. The whole family, they've been very close to all the players, and they mean a lot. And Coach Tarkanian, if you're a coach and you follow after him, and the only thing he wanted to do was win, and he had the formula to win. If you can go from Long Beach State playing a 1-2-2 zone to Las Vegas playing run and gun, and he always made sure he coached the talent he had, not had a system and just try to force it on players. And that's the reason why you see so many players go pro, because he gave us a chance to play. He let us be ourselves and let us play.
Thank you. Rebel fans, it's been an honor. You can only imagine someone who grew up here, the chance to be able to do this. The first player I ever was on the playground when I was out there jumping was Danny Tarkanian. I was a little Danny Tarkanian. That's who I wanted to be. This is such a great representation of what the Tarkanian family has done. This is a family business. And not only with the immediate family, but this is the extension. Las Vegas Running Rebel fans, thank you very much for hearing a little bit more of the story of Coach Tarkanian's family. Ed, thank you. Gary, thank you. Sam, thank you, sir. Thank you.
I think through everyone's story, there's this obvious theme of this admiration and respect for Coach Tarkanian, for all those who got to come into his life, or those he brought into his to give some chances to that otherwise weren't going to come. And a very unique story comes now from a guy he had at Fresno State. It's Chris Heron to tell his story.
Thank you, and it's extremely difficult to crunch into 5 minutes how I feel about Coach Tarkanian. Words cannot express the honor and gratitude I have to be here today to celebrate his life and share with you some of the memories that we had at Fresno State together. At 18 years old, I made a decision that would impact my life forever. That decision caused me to lose my scholarship at Boston College. And at 18 years old, I had lost my way. I went from the McDonald's All-American to the kid that no one would give a second chance. Until I received the phone call from Coach Tark. To be quite honest, I don't remember much of the phone call. I was in shock and awe. And I just wanted to listen to his voice. Until he said, "I want you to play at Fresno State." My heart dropped. And at that moment, I knew where I was going to spend the next 4 years of my life. I hung up the phone, I looked at my mom, and I said, "I'm going to Fresno State. But where is Fresno State, Mom?" After learning it was in California, I immediately thought of LA, Showtime, Hollywood. That wasn't the case. Instead, I followed him to a place I never heard of. It was 3 hours away from the coast. It was 100-plus degrees in the summer. And at the time, Fresno was more known for its agriculture than it was its hoops. I remember walking to his office to meet him for the first time. My heart was racing like it is today. My hands were sweating. I was about to meet the living legend, expecting this larger-than-life character sitting behind a desk. But instead, I got his amazing smile, his soft handshake, and a welcome to Fresno. I must say, though, I had no idea what I had signed up for. I had no idea I was going to spend the next 4 years of my life in a defensive stance. Doing thousands of closeouts and run-glide runs for conditioning. And I can honestly say in front of you today, I have no idea what the amoeba defense is. It was a tough, hard-nosed, passionate way to play the game, and it suited me well. He made me as a person and as a player. Our team was tough to manage at times at Fresno State. Sometimes, to be honest, unmanageable. But he coached us with respect and love. He wanted us to be great players. But he wanted us to be great men. And he introduced us to his community, his home. He instilled the importance of giving back. He wanted his pride and passion for Fresno to show in his players. He told us to be loyal to Fresno, and the people of the Valley would return the favor, and they did. Those 4 years, we had the greatest fans that supported us through thick and thin. My most memorable moments at Fresno with Coach are not about wins and losses. They are about humility, compassion, and family. I remember going back home for the first time to play against UMass on ESPN. I remember walking through that tunnel, scared to death, to a sold-out arena. But I knew in my heart I was ready and prepared with Coach Tarkanian by my side. He knew how big the moment was for me, and he coached me through it. I remember having the best cheerleaders at Fresno State. No. Coach Tark's granddaughters. I remember taking the floor and always comforting to know that Mrs. Tarkanian was praying for us. His love for Armenian food has been passed down. Hummus and tabbouleh, I never heard of it and I still have trouble spelling it, is a staple in my house. Coach Tark's office was spotless, his desk meticulous. And I remember walking into that office one day as a broke 19-year-old college kid, 3,000 miles away from home. I walked in to ask him to borrow a couple of bucks, expecting at least a 20. He handed me a 5 and said, "Chris, don't spend it all in one place." I truly admired the fact that Coach Tarkanian never needed nor wanted the spotlight. He always gave that to his players. But during one of my darkest moments, as I was announcing at a press conference that my struggles with substance abuse had once again got the best of me, he walked in with me. He sat down by my side And he cried with me into the cameras. And through all that, he never looked down on me. He never talked bad about me. No one believed in me more than Coach Tarkanian did. I am not and never will be a running rebel. I am not a national champion. And my career cannot match up with the legends that played here. But I can say this with pride. We all share one common bond, that we played for the greatest coach to ever coach this game. So that leaves me with this. The name that will live on forever, Tark the Shock. I must say I never met him. The Tark I knew was gentle, humble, hardworking. He taught me about forgiveness and empathy. He wore his heart on his sleeve and would give his shirt off his back. He was an amazing dad, a really cool grandpa, and he was and always will be the most loyal, best friend anyone could have in life. Coach, I love you. And I know my mom is waiting in a long line in heaven to thank you. God bless.
Chris, that was amazing. Thank you. I'm going to go diversion just for a second because it's important to me for what I learned here. I had this great old professor named Al Patterud who passed away, broadcasting school, and gave us, like one of the players was saying, as did Tark, you know, taught you how you do it, and then said, now I'm going to give you some room and you do it and show me how you can create. And that's what Al Patterud did for me in a lot of ways. Although his criticism of me was, you just wrote a script for 9 cameras and 17 actors, and we have 1 camera and a bunch of amateurs. So to that end, I'm going to minimize in this segment and try to follow Dr. Patterud's advice as I bring up some former UNLV players. Moses Scurry, Eldridge Hudson, Jackie Robinson, Ricky Sobers, Leon Szymanski, Reggie Theus. All right, somebody show some leadership and pick up a microphone first. What we're going to do, there's a lot of traffic. I want to pass the mic around. You guys got a couple already. And like we were talking about, Coach letting you create. If you want to go somewhere, go somewhere. But I want to know, what was your first impression of him, like the first time you met him? And what's the last impression? What did he teach you? What are you going to carry on in your life? What is it that you practice in your life that you learned from Coach Tark?
Me first.
It doesn't mean you have to go first.
Well, before I get started, I have to say hello to Lois. Because without you, I don't know where Tark would have been. Yeah. And your beautiful family, Danny, everybody. I have to say hello, Don Weimer. Where are you at? I have not seen you in 1,000 years. What's up, man? You know, we had a game last night, and I didn't actually know I was going to be able to make it. So I didn't really come prepared to say anything, but there's so many emotions that go through my mind and my heart when I start to think about Tark. A lot of them really funny too, Ricky. My first impression of Tark when I met him, I was a 10th grader in high school. And in those days, you could recruit 24/7. He was at every single one of my games. And if he wasn't there, Lynn Archibald was there. My high school coach introduced me one day, and Tark was one of those guys that no matter if he was in the hood or he was up over on the top of the hill, he got along with everybody. And I think that's one of the things that keeps eating in my heart, is that my relationship with him is about my relationship with all of you. Because me coming to Las Vegas, UNLV, being in school here, has given me relationships that have lasted my whole life and that will last forever. All of the people that I've seen here, the opportunity to have my jersey in this arena, I don't know. I was a good basketball player, but Jerry Tarkanian made me play as hard as I possibly could play. He got the most that I could give as a basketball player and as a person on the floor. And I think that's one of the greatest compliments a player can ever give a coach. I hope one of my guys ever say that about me one day. And that's my overall impression. He was always there. When I wanted to coach, he was there. When Lewis Brown tried to hit me with a trash can, true story.
He did.
Tark said, "Lou, no, Jack, go get Lou." Holy cow. Right? No, Jim won over on the side there. And Lou was serious because I was a freshman. I'll never forget the time that Tark came to one of my games, and, you know, for some reason, I don't know why they would do a thing like this, but he always referenced back to basketball. There's a lot of phrases. And he said, "Someone was shooting at the bus, and me and Coach Archibald, we dove for a loose ball." Then one time, remember, he got in a car accident. He was telling me about the car accident. I'll never forget. He said, "Reggie, I took a charge." There are so many. There's just so many great things that I can remember about Coach Tarkanian. Things that I live by today. The one thing that I can always take, not only to my players, but in my own personal life, he showed me how to be successful, and success comes out of hard work. If without the hard work, you'll never be successful. I remember Tark was one of the innovators. Everybody always calls him the innovator. He's one of the ones that, you know, playing up-tempo basketball, that's where this started. It started not in this building, but in the convention center. That everything you do in your life comes out of that hard work. Everything you do in your life, your successes that you have will come from the work and the teachings that you learn as a team player and the work that you put in on the floor. Those are the things that I took with me when I left UNLV into my different careers that I've had. And now it's one of the things that I continue to try to teach my own players, is that the fun comes out of the hard work. And the hard work and the fun, there is winning. Don't worry about the winning. It will come. If you do the work, it will come. Thank you. I'll never forget the one of the last things I've heard Tark say. I had the fortune to be at the Hall of Fame when he was inducted. He said, "Reggie," he says, "you're a good coach." He said, "can you still shoot it?" That's what I remember. Thank you. Thank you. Listen, if it was a basketball, they would all want it. Now it's a microphone, nobody wants it.
I don't know how to pass.
First off, I want you guys to stand. You guys are fans. My fans, I want you guys to stand. Give yourself a round of applause. Thank you, guys. Without you guys, there will be no Moses Scurry. Thank you, guys. Thank you. God bless each and every one of you guys. Thank you. Thank you. I would like to thank my wife and kids, which is here in the stands. Thank you guys very much. Thank you. They kept me grounded. Coach Jerry Tarkanian changed my life. I come from Brooklyn, New York. Took me out of a bad situation. Put me into a great situation. And I'm here as a man. He taught me the game of life through the game of basketball. Coach Jerry Tarkanian was one of a kind. Definitely a father to me. And it's a pleasure to be sitting among some of the greats. I thank you guys for giving me this opportunity to be here. Words can't even describe what kind of person Coach Jerry Tarkanian was. Tarkanian is a name that I'll never forget. Family here, I'd like to thank you guys for everything you guys done for me. Forget about the Kardashians. I'll give Jimmy Kimmel a call tonight. We'll get a show started here. Thank you guys. But I'm not going to sit here and go on and on. Like I say, Coach Jerry Tarkanian is one of the greatest coaches of all time. And it's a pleasure to be here in Las Vegas amongst you guys. Like I say, thank you guys very much. I love you guys. Thank you.
When I was being recruited to come to UNLV out of the community college, Coach Tark wasn't there actually recruiting me. He was recruiting Jarvis Bass Knight. George played with Jarvis at Mount San Antonio, and they were coming to see how Jarvis played, and I just happened to have one of those phenomenal games, and Coach Tark saw a hard-working young man, and he wanted to know a little bit more about me, so I did a little bit more background check. And my very first time ever in Las Vegas was in February 1984, when I came out on my recruiting visit. My flight was due to land at noon, and then the Rebels were playing in the Thomas and Mack at 1 o'clock against Long Beach State. And this was for the PCAA championship. And when the plane landed, everybody got off the plane, and I was looking around for anybody that said UNLV or a sign or my name. And it was 12:15 and 12:30. And I was getting really worried. I thought they forgot about me. And then it was about 12:45, and I thought, this is terrible. And then Coach Bill Lastra came up and said, "Hey, are you Szymanski?" I said, "Yeah." He goes, "Come on, we're late, let's go." I didn't realize that Thomas and Mack Arena was right across from the airport. And I went from being a panicked, stricken young recruit to walking down the tunnel and out onto the floor. And this was Danny Tarkanian's senior game. And A few feet away from where I'm sitting right now, Mrs. Tarkanian and Coach and Danny were embracing, and there were 18,500 loyal, loving Rebel fans cheering as loud as they could. And it was very surreal as I walked across the floor, and they told me, you're going to sit on the bench, and you're going to watch this team. And I saw the Rebels play for the very first time in this amazing arena with the most amazing fans in America. And I thought, wow, what an honor it is to be asked to come and play at this university. And then Coach Tark subsequently told me, he said, Leon, we're going to offer you a full-ride scholarship to play with the university, but you're never going to start one game for us. And I thought, wow, that's brutally honest. But it was also genius, because Coach Tark always was 3 steps ahead, 4 steps ahead, 10 steps ahead of everyone else. And he had a plan, and he told me, he said, I want you to go in every day and work as hard as you can on the court and in the classroom. And if we're playing Georgetown next week, I want you to know Georgetown's offense and defense better than Georgetown knows it, and kick our guys' butts in practice every day. Make them mentally and physically ready to play. And I thought, if he's that honest with 11 other scholarship players, everybody's going to know their role, and we're going to be very successful. And over the next 3 years that I was able to play for this great coach, we won 98 games and lost 11. So I just want to thank you again from the bottom of my heart for giving me an opportunity. As a result, I was able to get my bachelor's degree in business administration, my master's degree in public administration, and my law degree from UNLV, thanks to the Tarkanians. Thank you so much.
My name is Ricky Sobers. And I'm living proof that dreams do come true. Jerry Tarkanian is a dream maker. See all these great players coming, paying homage to him. They all had dreams. We all had dreams of being great college players. Some of us wanted to go on and be professional players. I was able to realize that dream, and I'd like to thank him from the bottom of my heart for helping me realize my dream. What an incredible family he made. Lois, my deepest condolences to you and everyone in your family. I want to try and keep this light, so I'll take it to another area that involves a couple of situations. When I was being recruited by Jerry, before I actually met him, I was being recruited by another big-time school, and I wanted to find out, you know, what was going on with this university. I mean, how does this coach tick? And I found out very rapidly that this particular coach wanted his players to make an appointment to come see him whenever they had a problem. I thought that was really strange. But when I had a problem, Jerry had an open door policy. And he helped me solve whatever problem I had on my mind. So he's an incredible man with an incredible legacy. You see it here. And I'd like to thank everyone involved with his family. It's such an incredible, incredible opportunity to realize that dream.
There you go.
You go live.
What's good, my Rebel fans? All right, we know Eldridge Hudson, a.k.a. L. Hud. And, of course, I think I was the knucklehead of the Rebel group, pretty much. But I tell you what, I'm going to call him my coach because I know without him in my life, I wouldn't be doing the things that I'm doing right now. And when I say that, I hope my partner in crime is in the house, Freddie Banks. Freddie Banks allowed me the blessing to be with him at Canyon Springs High School, where we coach at. And thank you. And if you come to our games, you notice we always have our towels. We don't buy them, but we have them. And we have the infamous empty seat. So for me, I try to emulate, I bring out my inner Junior Tarkanian. That's what I do. I find myself saying things that coach used to say to us when I was young. And I look at Fred, I'm like, damn, did I just say that? You know, and he's like, yeah, you did. You know, it's like, you know, and I'm going to try to lighten the load right now. You know, I remember coach, he would come into the locker room at halftime, cussing us out, you know, and one game I forgot, it was, he came in and he threw the chalk against the board and it splattered. And he had to duck and he ran out the gym. Remember that? He ran right out the locker room. It was the funniest thing we ever seen, but we couldn't laugh, you know, because he was serious, you know. So we sitting there looking like we hitting each other, like, you know, are we going to laugh or no, you know. And it's amazing. I find myself doing the same things that he used to do. So I guess what they say, life imitates art. And he was such a great artist. You know, and I'm sitting here with these guys right here, and I don't know if you guys know, but I started at the convention center. So I used to watch these guys in L.A., and that's what made me come here, outside of some other things. And I'll tell you real quick, one game in high school, my coach had called a timeout, and I went to the bench like, what do you call timeout for? You know, the problem child. And he said, well, we're going to run this play. I said, no, it's not going to work. Just give me the ball and tell everybody to get out the way, you know. But unbeknownst to me, there's like Syracuse, Duke, North Carolina, all these guys are sitting in this, you know, all these coaches sitting at the game, and they all left. Coach Tark stayed. And I'm here. So that's my coach. That is my coach. You know, and to my extended family, love you guys dearly. Mama Tark, you know what you do for me all the time. Jody, Danny, George, Pam, love you guys. You know, it's amazing how a man this big can change a whole damn valley. You know, honestly, think about that. That's just his character, his drive, and his heart. Frank Sinatra, I don't know, Rat Pack, it's Jerry Tarkanian, period, point blank. Let's just keep it real, you know. So in closing, I want to try something because I told you I'm the knucklehead, I'm the problem child. I need everybody to stand up. Stand up with me. When I say coach, you say Tark. Coach! Coach! When I say coach, you say Tark. See, that's what coach would do right there. When I say Tark, you say family. Tark! We love you.
My name is Jackie Robinson. There's a couple of things I want to talk about because, one, A, I've known the Tarkanian family probably longer than anybody. And I've got a chance to watch my brother, who was Sam Robinson, play for Jerry. I got a chance to go over and babysit and stay over with Pam and Danny and Jody, and so I grew up, me and my younger brother. So it was always something that I wanted to do, because I grew up in watching every single basketball game, and my mom spent time with Lois and the kids. And then my brother, they mentioned that my brother won the first championship at PCC, and then he lost to Cerritos. I never forgot that. And when they lost to Cerritos, the only thing I could, on my conscious mind that whole time, that I wanted to play for Tark, I wanted to get even with Cerritos, because I couldn't. The feeling that I saw from the standpoint of the sadness from Jerry's face and my brother, it just made an impact on me from that point. But one of the things I want to talk about also, besides what he's done for me from a standpoint of professional career, but a lot of things that people don't know about Coach was very socially conscious. We came here in 1973. I came with Jerry. And 6 years prior to that, Las Vegas, in the casinos, African Americans could not go into the casinos. Jerry Tarkanian came here, and we came here in 1973, and we were predominantly African American owned, team that was primarily African American. And I remembered that we came out of the tunnel, and when we came out of the tunnel, the mascot was a gentleman who was wearing a Confederate outfit and a Confederate flag. True story. Well, the next game, that guy was retired. True story. I really didn't pay attention to it, but it caught his mind that he was conscious of that. And he said, listen, we can't do that. Also, the same thing when there were cheerleaders here, and then also at the time, I think Robert Smith's wife and several other folks were there. There was one of the tribe for the cheerleading squad. And there were no African Americans on the cheerleading squad. They went to Jerry, talked to Jerry. Next game, there was part of the squad that were cheerleaders that were involved in that situation. He didn't have to do that. He didn't have to do that. And you got to understand something, because I got the chance to sit down in front of John Wooden. And John Wooden at that time was the establishment. Kentucky, John Wooden, and those guys. First thing he told me, he said, if you ever play for me, your hair can't be longer than a half inch. You can't have any hair on your face. You can't, and it was a list of different things. You got to understand something. When Jerry Tarkanian came here and started the Running Rebels, think how much he pushed against the grain and did it his way. He never came to us and said, listen, you can't be an individual. If you had an afro, he said, listen, just keep it neat, keep it in presentable. And then the change, I go against the establishment that wanted to have an offense that goes 5, 6, 7, 8 passes before you shoot, to go to the Running Rebels. Well, you got to understand something. The establishment had basketball that was 50 points, 60 points a game. Here Jerry comes in and takes us, anti-establishment. We average 111 points a game. Without any shot clock, without any three-point play. Who would, you know, you think about it, who would ever, you know, because, and the reason is so remarkable to me, because I grew up watching the 1-2-2 zone the whole time. And then, like Mr. Wright said, powered it inside. And then the change that was so far in advance from a basketball standpoint. That was amazing. My brother talked about that how my mother passed. That was my brother, Sam Robinson. And we grew up not having a father. And it may seem every 6 months or a year or something like this, whatever. And especially from the standpoint, you know, although my big brother was married and I was a freshman here in school. And 18 years old, and to lose my mom. For me, I was 18 years old and I was lost. I had no father, I had no mother at that point. It was a rock of our family. I didn't know what I was going to do from a standpoint. I went and had a conversation with Coach, and I said, Coach, I don't know, I just want to give up. You know, I said, I don't want to play basketball anymore. He said, Jackie, you have to be strong for your mother, what she put into you. You have to be strong. You have to be strong for your family. Everything she's worked for and did for you right now, you can't let it go. And Coach used to always have these conversations with me because I always wanted to talk about basketball because I thought that not having a mom and a dad, my only way out was to play in the NBA. And Coach would always talk about the community. I didn't want to talk about the community, Coach. I wanted, you know, how can I get better than doing this with Jackie? The community. He used to take me over to Susan Malasky's house and Irwin's house and other people like this and the Jacobs house and everything to see. Because I grew up in the inner city. You got to understand something. When you get a chance to go out and see those type of things, it makes an impact on your life. And that there was life beyond basketball. And what he was instilling in me was saying that, listen, I see in you can go much farther than basketball. At the time, I didn't see it. And so when I was recruited here and then Sammy Davis Jr. and all those guys were here and Coach took me to talk to them about the community and what was going on and how things had advanced. And then to round it up now, going through a process of me being a person, losing my mother freshman year, father not being around, and then coming up to last October where Jerry was came over. It was the last public time I'd got a chance to see him, and the groundbreaking. And here I am sitting on a piece of property where when Jerry was telling me about and showing me about what's going on with Sammy Davis Jr. and what happened, what they wanted to see and realize from a standpoint, from an African-American standpoint, to one day have a hotel that where an African-American owned it. And here I am, sitting here next to Coach, being in his position. And then after Dina Titus came up, she gave me a proclamation. And I came back and I sat down. And you got to understand, Jerry couldn't talk at that time. And he sit there and he says, Jackie, I'm proud of you. I'm very proud of you. That's the only thing he said out of the hour and a half. And at that point, I got it. Because if you understand something about Jerry Tarkanian, he could say, you played good, you good job. But when he said, I'm proud of you, that means you got it. You understood what he was trying to say and what he was trying to implement into you. And if it wasn't for that, he'll be with me forever. And Lois, Pam, you know, Jody, George, Danny, I love you guys. But then the last thing I want to say to you, Pam, you know, we talked and we hugged right before the service. And you said something to me, said, listen, my dad was in such pain, he wouldn't let go. We wanted him to let go because of so much pain. But it doesn't surprise me because he's never quitting anything in his life, even to the end. That's what type of person he is. Now, we're all sitting here today, and we're sitting around here and we're celebrating Jerry. If we want Jerry Tarkanian's spirit to live on, then if it's in our faith, if it's in our families, if it's in everything we work and we do, give your maximum effort. Because that's what Jerry Tarkanian did in his whole life. Thank you.
Thank you, guys. One more time for the UNLV guys.
You know, a couple of things that were spoken just now hit me. Maybe I came to a pretty enlightened place 30-odd years ago because, you know, Coach Knapp in football, I think, was doing a lot of the same things as Coach Tark. I played behind a black quarterback, ahead of a black quarterback, and we really didn't care about color. And Coach Tark didn't recognize color. He recognized talent. And I think it's a mark of his legacy, just what he did in so many ways, so many of the stories that were referenced right there. And that's part of the, you know, enduring legacy that Coach Tarkanian leaves behind. The man now who's led the UNLV team to great success and continues to follow in Jerry's footsteps now is Coach Rice. Dave Rice, come up to the podium.
Thank you, Kenny. I was just handed a proclamation from the governor of the state of Nevada, Brian Sandoval, who declared March 1st, 2015 as Jerry Tarkanian Day. We're all here for the same reason, and how appropriate it is that we're in the house that Coach Tark built. Our current Runner Rebel team is over in Section 113, and they're honored to be here today. I can tell you that every one of them had an opportunity to spend some time with Coach Tark, and as he came to practice, as he came to our games, they'd all run over to greet him, and they understood the impact that he had on the legacy that he left behind. And every day we get up in the morning, we work hard to try to live up to something that was so hard to do, and we can't say enough thanks to Coach Tark for what he's meant to this program, certainly. But our Runnin' Rebel basketball program wants to make special acknowledgement to Lois, to Pam, to Jody, to Danny, to George, the family. This is a day for Coach Tarkini, we understand that, but it's also a day for Lois. His great point guard, and without Lois, it wouldn't have been the same. And so, Lois, thank you so much. ...509 wins, only 105 losses. 4 Final Fours, a national championship, multiple conference titles, NBA draft picks, but it just tells part of the story. It's really about a man who made a difference in the lives of all of us, and that's why we're all here today. Coach Tark was a tremendous delegator. Everyone wanted to be on Coach Tark's team. That's why so many former players are here. Think about the way he delegated. Think about the assistant coaches, the academic advisors who are here, the trainers, the equipment managers, the administrators, and the fans. We all want to be part of Coach Tark's team. That's what this is all about. And I think the biggest thing I tell people when they ask, well, what was it like to play for Coach Tark? What was it like to work for Coach Tark? He delegated, he brought great people in around him, and yet it was never a doubt who was in charge. It was Coach Tark, and that's what made him so special. I think the thing about Coach Tark is that he was such a special man. It's been a difficult time these last 3 weeks for our program, and yet it's been an opportunity for basketball fans, for a community of Las Vegas to celebrate the life of certainly a fantastic basketball coach, but an even better man. Some of the stories have been told from some of the former players reminded me of one story. It was 1991. We were undefeated. We were playing a team that'll go unnamed that was near the bottom of the standings in the Big West at the time. The other team scored the last two baskets of the first half to cut our halftime deficit to 28 points. Coach Tark, who was not a yeller, not a screamer, and yet players, we know he had a way of getting his point across, walked into the locker room and started throwing chalk. That was before the days of the grease board. Throwing chalk, and about once or twice a year, Coach Tark just wanted to kind of send that message. Larry Johnson, who was in the front of the room, looked up and said, "Coach, aren't we up 28 points?" Coach Tark burst into laughter. He said, "Larry, you got me again." But that was what the man was certainly all about. And it was special to be able to play for him, to be able to work for Coach Tark. And at a time when certainly there's sadness, it's also a time for us to be able to celebrate a great man. It was a man who, after I graduated in 1991, gave me an opportunity to be an assistant coach on his final staff. And 20 years later, was sitting at a press conference in the Thomas & Mack Center when I was being named the head coach. He was always there for all of us. And that's why there are players from Riverside City College. There are players from Pasadena City College, from Long Beach, from UNLV, from Fresno State. There are fans. There are administrators. Everyone is here. And you know what? This is not just Coach Tark's day, because that's not how he would want it. That's not what he was all about. This is all of our days. This is about a day of celebration and his legacy, what he's meant to all of us, and the difference that he's made in all of our lives. And that's why we're here. And what a special man, what a special day. I'll leave you with this. It was a phone call that I received several months after I'd gotten the head coaching job at UNLV. And it was never going to be about me. It was going to be about a program and trying to live up to the legacy that he'd left and those big shoes and how difficult it's been for everyone since. But he, on the phone, and we had an opportunity to talk so many times. And we talked about basketball, and even later in life, he still has such a great feel for players and how to make things work and how to make things happen. He said, "Dave, just remember one thing. Listen to what people say, but at the end of the day, make your decisions, and absolutely without question, do what's right." And this is what really struck me, and it was what Coach Tark was all about. He said, "Try to be better tomorrow than you were today, and try to be better in 2 days than you are tomorrow. And if you do that, you'll be successful in life." That's what Coach Tark was all about, the difference he made. 509 wins, 105 losses only, 4 Final Fours, a national championship. It was the difference that he made in people, and that's why we're all here today. And so I say, Coach Tark, we love you. Rest in peace. God bless you. God bless the Tarkanian family, and God bless the Running Rebels. Thank you.
I'm just going to try to be better than I was last segment. That introduction was terrible. Great speech, though. Thank you. I'm coming to you this time as a member of the Screen Actors Guild. I am. I was in the movie Basketball, very notable film, very important in cinematic history. More recently, worked with Marshawn Lynch in a commercial. He's my homie. He is. I invited him to come down here and play dice, but he didn't make it. Still working out his deal. Coach Tarkanian did some acting. He's sort of like a cross between Sidney Poitier and Leo DiCaprio if the scripts had been lost and no one knew what to do. He sucked, actually, at acting. But the thing is, he's just this lovable guy. You've heard all the stories, the affection people have for him, and all that he put out. He's just, "I'm me. Take it or leave it. Here I am." And here he is.
Shut up, punk. Let's get this over with.
I'll take the two on the right.
Let's do it.
My friend, you'll always have a backup in this town.
On our feet, slamming, ball in the park, nothing but
thrills in the dark. We chill. We never get spanked a place. We call the takers.
Guys, he looks pretty good, huh? I'm Tark.
He's a great player, but I don't think we can get him in academically.
You don't think so?
I don't think so.
All the top 10 teams that we play, they do the same dance, don't you know? Cause they move too quick.
Go River!
They're falling down like a domino. The other coaches don't know the first thing about towel etiquette. Tarkanian,
oh, he knows.
He snaps the seat when the towel's wet. All the fans down in Vegas can't say. Like a Tarkanian.
Tommy, I thought we were playing for fun.
This is fun.
I fold.
Well, baby, the king must fold.
Jerry, wake up.
Applauding the fact that you still water.
Towel?
Yeah, I don't have one. Who does?
Oh, here we go. Jerry Tarkanian, ladies and gentlemen, thank you. From a UNLV basketball coach. Thank you, sir.
I know you're famous for this. Let me ask you, you've been watching shows a week. How are we doing? How's the show look so far?
Really?
You got bad hands.
Really?
All right.
All right, help me out here. On the program tonight, ladies and gentlemen, the fabulous Roseanne. Roseanne is on the program, ladies and gentlemen.
Steve Lawrence and Edie Gourmet.
That's right. We have, ladies and gentlemen. They don't know we have this. We have a piece of tape of Steve Gourmet from the Tonight Show in 1954 when he was 17 years old. It's very funny. You'll get a kick out of this. And who else do we have?
Steve Lawrence and Edie Gourmet.
Yes, yes, and I believe Steve Lawrence and Edie Gourmet will be here. And from the new show friend, Courtney Cox. Jerry Tarkanian. Thank you, Jerry. Thank you very, very much. We'll be right back right after this.
They told me to make fun of his acting. That wasn't my idea. I thought he was all right. He had good timing. Residual checks are still going to be coming in, so you get that. I don't know which is more difficult, being a coach's wife or a coach's son, but we have one of each, and I believe they're going to speak more about the joys of being involved with Jerry Tarkanian and his great career, Lois and Danny Tarkanian.
First of all, I just want to thank everyone for showing up today and showing your support. It's been so wonderful to listen to all these stories from the different players, the different people that have been involved in my father's career, and tell you a little bit about the kind of person he was, the impact he had on their lives, and the difference that he made with his life. In fact, over the past 2 weeks, our family have been overwhelmed by the support that and the condolences, the calls, emails, texts from so many people that have told us how much my father had meant to them in their lives, how they changed their lives, and it's just been overwhelming. But what I'd like to do for you, if it's okay today, is to tell you a little bit about what my father would be saying. My father had a very blessed life. As you just saw up in that video, what a wonderful life he had. He had an incredible mother that gave him everything he needed to be successful in life, and he loved her dearly. He had the perfect wife to walk hand in hand with him through life, but actually it was battle through battle for him through life. And I know he loved her dearly. He had some of the most loyal and best friends anybody can have, and he loved you guys so much to the day he died. And he always talked about how fortunate he was to play for the greatest athletic director there ever was in all of sports, Brad Rothermel. But he said over and over again, and he said it in the national championship ceremony they had here in the Thomas and Mack Center, that he was so fortunate to be able to coach in front of the greatest fans in all of college basketball, all of you Running Rebel fans here today and throughout the state. For those of you that can remember some of those games and the times when he coached, there was never, ever an environment in sports like we had here during that time period. The red carpet, the light show, the multicolored lights, the fireworks, the jaws claps before, the laser shark circling the arena. In fact, my dad even had his own mascot, a shark mascot, the only coach in the history of sports to have his own mascot for his team. But what my father was most fortunate with, and we have seen that throughout the years growing up, is the wonderful players that he was able to be associated with and that helped make his career. He had always said, he and my mother both had said, the Riverside City College years were the golden years of their lives. They were so proud of what those players accomplished in their lives, from where they came from to where they ended up. And they were so proud of how the kids of those RCC players went on and became, one worked for Arnold Schwarzenegger in the Capitol in California and all the other success stories. He talked about how Long Beach State was the greatest success story with what they had and probably the history of sports. You need to rethink about this for now. Long Beach State was a Division II program before he got there. In 3 years, that program that had 7 scholarship players, that's all that they could afford at Long Beach, they took UCLA during their run of national championships, took them to the wire and should have beat them. My dad said it would have been the greatest upset in the history of college basketball. He had these wonderful players that were willing to come with him to a small school with no money and be a part of something that was just an incredible, incredible experience. For me as a young boy, that's what I've always just dreamed of, the fortunate things that they accomplished at Long Beach. But here at UNLV, we had something that was even more special. We had more resources. We had more money. We had the best athletic director in the country. But boy, we had it going great here. The last 10 years, my father coached me. He won 330 games, 10 straight league championships, three Final Fours, and the national championship by the largest margin in the history of college basketball. I forgot somebody that I know that I would have forgotten. He had the greatest assistant coaches you could possibly ever have here. Ann Archibald with her husband Lynn at one time, Tim Gergerich, Mark Workington, Star, all you guys. Couldn't have had a greater coaching staff and been so fortunate to be part of all of it. But I think the thing my father was most fortunate to have was the ability to live out his life here in Las Vegas. This couldn't have been a better town for him. He loved people. He loved to go out and talk to people. He loved the enjoyment of being a people person. And he was here at the beginning of the formation of this town. He helped create this town, bond this town together, create memories and excitement that this town has in its history. And he always loved this town so dearly. When he had to make up his mind whether he was going to leave Long Beach State and come here to UNLV, there was a UNLV booster, little goofy guy named Mike Tony. He came running down on the court and he said, "Coach, you gotta come to UNLV." He said, "You won't want to leave until you go to heaven." And that's exactly what he did. Thank you.
I've never done this big Las Vegas introduction before, but I'm going to give it a shot. From the Palazzo Hotel, he stars as chairman of the board in Frank the Man, comma, the music, Bob Anderson.
And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friends, I'll make it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I'll live the life that's full, travel each and every highway, more, much more than this, I did it my way. Regrets, we've all had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do, I saw it through without exemption. I've planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I am sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew. But through it all, when there was doubt, I ate it up and spit it out. I faced it all, and I stood tall, and did it my way. I've laughed and cried, I had my fill, my share of losing, and now as tears subside, I find it all so amusing to think that I did all that, and may I say, not in a shy way, oh no, not me, I did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not to say the things he truly feels, and not the words of one who kneels. The record shows he took the blows and did in his way. His way.
Thank you very much.
I was totally going to sing that song just now, so you get that. Bob Anderson, great job. Thank you. A lot of folks have asked, after Coach's passing, how can they honor him? We've done okay today, and we'll continue to do is just talking about him, you know, bring him up again. And I'm sure the family's going to carry this day in their hearts, all the wonderful words that were spoken. If you want to do something direct, go to One for Tark, that's O-N-E-F-O-R, Tark, onefortark.com, and put some scholarship money in the coach's name. Jody, thank you for inviting me. I've never been prouder to be a part of UNLV. Drive safely, and long live Tark.